Es computer. Okay. I see that my recording is working. And now I just need to change share the window. Change the window I share. It's a little bit complicated, but I hope that I will manage. I should stop share. Let me stop share and then I will start share appropriate window. Introduction. Just a second. Conic program. Here it is. Okay. I will start sharing. Okay, I hope that you see well the PDF of Accra read of Conic programming. Okay, then we can start working. Okay, so it's a very fascinating topic. Conic programming is a relatively recent part of convex optimization. And a significant part of it, if not the central, was introduced by my teacher, Arkady Nemirovsky, and I'm very proud to tell about this. Okay. And what is conic programming? We say, it's a way to generalize linear programming. Yes, if we have linear programming to minimize the objective function, subject to constraints greater or equal zero, we can say that vector of constraints belongs to positive orthant, belongs to a cone. And then we, instead of positive orthant, we can use other cones. And the requirements to the cones, first of all, what is a cone? If I have a vector which belongs to a cone, for example, here I put some point, or maybe I will put it on white. Let me do something on whiteboard. So if I have a cone, then usually we consider a cone which starts in the origin. So we have coordinates. We have coordinates, for example, x1. Okay, I need to move my camera, I see. Remove a little bit reflections. Okay, I already see that I should start a little bit down. So if I have axis, okay, you see here, but if I have axis x1, x2, what will be a cone? We consider cone which starts from the origin. For example, everything here between is a cone. And what does it mean? That if I take arbitrary point x and drive a vector, then any multiply of this x will also belong to the cone. And this is our first condition. Yes, you have lambda x belonging to the cone. But important thing, the cone may be in one direction, or one can continue it in opposite. If I multiply x by negative number, I will get here. But what we consider directed cones. So we say that for positive lambda, it belongs to the cone. And for negative, if I take minus x, for example, it doesn't belong to the cone. And also a very nice property, if x and y belong to a cone, if I have two vectors, x and y, which belong to a cone, then if cone is convex, then sum of x plus y belongs to the cone itself as well. And this is the other way of describing convexity, a little bit different from what you're used to. And yes?
Actually, for convex cone, you can even generalize it to any linear combination of x and y. For positive coefficients, it's all being the cone.
Yes, yes. You're right. You're right. You can you can write even lambda 1 x plus lambda 2 y. It should also belong to the cone. Thank you very much. Okay. And what else we say that cone somehow generalizes the notion of inequality. If we have for usual vector and we write a greater equal zero, we mean every component in the vector a is greater equal zero. It means that it belongs to the cone Rm plus to the positive R term. And if you say a greater equal b, then we say that difference is positive. Difference belongs to this cone. So in this way, we can generalize also for general cones, directed convex cones. If a greater than zero, then it belongs to the cone, and a greater than b in with this symbol k, it's that it difference belongs to the cone. And here is a graphical illustration. What does it mean? A greater than B, if I have this cone, which is original, what is the set of points that satisfies this inequality? A greater than B. A minus B belongs to the cone. It's easy to see that I should take original cone and shift it to the its corner, its how to say pole to the B,
and the all this
and all this set of points will be the set of points A which are greater or equal B. Any question, any comments to this? Okay, let's continue. Let's continue. And here we had the examples of cones. Of course, positive Ortand and Lorentz cone. Lorentz cone, it's so-called ice cream cone. Here, three-dimensional example. If I take a vector with components u1 and u2 and plot the graph of two norm of this vector, it will be like an ice cream cone which has opening 90 degrees. And what I require to be inside this cone, that the third coordinate u3 will be larger or equal, will belong to epigraph of this function. And this is the ice cream cone or second order cone. Any question on this? Okay, and very important cone, semi-definite cone of positive symmetric positive symmetric definite matrices. Why do we know that it is a cone? If I have positive semi-definite matrix, then if I multiply it by a positive scalar, it remains. Or if I have two positive semi-definite matrices, then their sum belongs, or weighted sum, like you mentioned. But it's directed cone, because if I multiply it by minus one, it is not positive semi-definite anymore. Any question, any comment on this? Okay. And then we say that, like we told, our generalization of linear programming problem is to minimize some linear function, linear objective function, subject to AX minus B belongs to a cone. And all those three cones give us three examples of conic programming optimization problems. So if cone is positive Artant, it's usual linear programming. If cone is quadratic cone, then we say it's convenient to split our operator AX in usual way, actually in two operators. One acts on this vector U, which is under two norm, and the other acts its scalar, its linear functional, D is a vector, to the third variable U3. And belong to the cone, it means that U3 is greater than two norm of U1 and U2 in our example. Yes, it's exactly what is written here. The third, the last variable, it's greater or equal than norm all previous. Any question, any comment? It's really new stuff, and it takes some time to get used to it.
Yes, I have a question.
Yes.
The optimization problem of minimize the scalar product C of X.
Yes.
Can we do more complex optimization problems?
In general, yes. In general, yes. The convention is, if you talk about standard conic programming, and a lot of theory and practical method is developed for linear objective function, but there is a possibility to work with nonlinear as well. But as you see from the lecture, most of theory, and it's very powerful. It's interestingly that this form includes a lot of important practical problems from science, engineering, and economics. But sometimes, yes, sometimes you can have general nonlinear objective, and even here you may have nonlinear function. Okay. And very important example, semi-definite programming. We have this general expression, so we minimize objective function. And we say that AX minus B belongs to the cone of positive semi-definite matrices. So we need to define what is this operator, which we take a n-dimensional usual vector AX and map it to the cone of semi-definite matrices. And it's defined in a very simple way. We take symmetric matrices, they don't have to be positive definite, matrix B and matrices A1 till AN, and says and the usual vector X in Rn, and say that AX is just sum of matrices AI multiplied by scalar. What is multiply scalar by a matrix? We know it's multiply all elements of this matrix by this scalar. And we sum it up. It happens that this is the general form of mapping, of linear mapping from vectors to matrices. You just should tell me what are the matrices, and that's all. Okay, any question, any comment on this?
Michael, so actually the calligraphic A is a row vector of the of all the A matrices, yes? It's actually, it's
row vector. It's like, you can think it's like a tensor. We even don't say about this because we don't use tensor notation. You may say it's somehow three-dimensional object, but we only define what is multi. I don't remember. I think Ron mentioned in last lecture or somebody else. He likes tensor notations. Yes.
Ron.
Yes. And then I'm preparing.
Tensor. It's exactly.
So like
this contracts tensor in one dimension, yes. Collapses tensor in one dimension. But we don't need this language because usual engineers and computer scientists are not used to tensor notation. So we just say that we have a set of matrices and we sum them up.
Okay, thanks.
Oh, Michael?
Yes.
All the matrices are symmetric?
Yes, as symmetric and of the same size. Yes, symmetric.
So, and S subscript n plus is symmetric, posidefinite.
Yes. Actually, in mathematics, if you say positive definite and positive semi-definite matrix, matrix, despite the definition is a little bit more general, people say that in order to avoid the complicated questions, it's healthy to say that they are symmetric. If you say positive definite matrices, we assume they are symmetric. Okay. And now we came to the question you already worked on. The notion of dual cone is very important because it's used for duality theory in conic programming. And we say that dual cone is, if I have this original cone, the dual cone is set of all vectors. If I take a vector from dual cone, it should have non-negative inner product with all vectors from the original cone. And in this simple illustration, two-dimensional illustration, if the inner cone is here, I should take a 90 degrees angle and draw this line, 90 degrees with this left part of this cone, yes? And here, opposite, I take 90 degrees with right line of this cone. And this white cone, it's dual, yes? Any point from here, any vector from here has a cute angle with the vectors from original cone. But also important that this is set of all vectors with this property. If I take any vector from outside, then there will be some vector in the original cone which has no cute angle, which has a negative inner product. And this was your question. And you know, I would even propose, is there any volunteer to show us a solution for the quiz?
Yes.
Positive argument is self-dual, yeah. And I will stop my sharing. And who it is? Who is a volunteer? Tell your name. Hello?
Yes, this is Ron.
And you want to share, do you want to share your screen?
Yes.
Okay, thank you very much.
I just want to ask if you can, because the connection was a bit abrupt a few minutes ago when you explained on the dual cone, if you can please repeat
that. Okay. Let me return to the sharing. So I have the original con, which is here. Yes, con K. Do you see it?
Yes, I can see it.
And I ask if I take arbitrary vector, for example, here where my pointer is the inner product of this vector positive with any vector from the K? And I say that yes, if I choose my vector, I don't know why in this way, that it is inside of this large cone, which I call K star, then yes, angle with any vector from original K will be cubed and the inner product will be positive. Okay, is it clear?
Yes, thank you.
And to get this dual cone, we just draw 90 degrees lines with the lines of the original cone. Okay, then just start showing us our one. I will stop my share. Okay. Please start your screen sharing.
I am sharing. Can you see my?
Yes.
Okay, so I wrote down the problem. The problem was show that the positive ortant R plus of N is a self dual cone. Mm-hmm. And we discussed that first we will show R plus N is self dual, and then we will show that it is a cone.
Okay, very good.
Okay, so the definition of the dual cone.
Dual.
Thank you. Dual. Okay. Mm-hmm. The definition of the dual cone is all the y's such that the scalar product between an x, which is in our space, and y will be positive. Mm-hmm. And
non-negative.
Yes, thank you. Okay, so if now we consider, a general scalar product where x is in R positive n, and we write it as a sum of elements, we see that each xi must be non-negative because it is in Rn.
Mm-hmm. Rn plus, yes.
And now the way I try to solve it is using induction on the number of dimensions. First showing that for n equals 1, for a one-dimensional x1 is non-negative, and the product of x1 times y1 is non-negative, then y1 must be non-negative. Mm. So y is in R plus 1.
Actually, Ron, I think I save a little bit your time. Your claim is on the top of your screen that sum xi yi is greater than zero if every x and every y is non-negative. I would say it's straightforward. Yes, every element in this product is non-negative. Of course, the sum of non-negative numbers is non-negative. Let's skip your induction and go. Did you try to go the other direction? If the vector is outside of this cone, yes.
Do you mean if I showed for a vector that is not in the cone?
Yes.
No.
Okay. Did anybody show the second part? Yes.
I can show, it's a bit not very beautiful written.
But, okay, maybe I show on the whiteboard. Okay.
It's the above directions. This one inside this one, and this one inside this one.
Okay, let's stop sharing. Ron, thank you very much. Yeah, and I just show on the whiteboard. It's very, very straightforward. So if I will show you even with the illustration to save a little bit of time. Okay. So this is my positive orthon, yes? Two-dimensional example. Of course, what we showed that if I take two vectors which belongs, this straightforward that the inner product is positive because all components are positive. So this is my vector X. And let me take vector Y out of this Y. And my question is, whether can I find vector X in the original cone such that inner product will not be positive? And I already saw this vector on the picture, yes? If I will take this vector X, the angle will be larger than 90 degrees. This is a graphical explanation. And if you want the algebraic explanation, we see that first coordinate of Y in this case is negative. And it's enough to take vector X with first component positive and all other zero, yes? Then the product of Y1 with X1 or X1 with Y1 will be, say I told that Y1 is less than zero then, and of course X1 is greater than zero, then this product is also less than zero, and this is my example that out of this cone, I have at least one point. So the conclusion is that Rn plus positive Rn is the set of all points which belong to the dual cone. So it's self-dual. Okay, and now I'm not sure how clear I was. Any question? Any comment on my explanation?
Yeah, so we need to show that all the points that that are in R plus are in the self cone, and that any point in the self cone
that all points in R plus are in the dual cone, yes, and any point out of it is not in dual cone, yes.
Okay.
Okay, maybe it's good time to take normal break without task, or do you want me to give the second mission before the break? What do you prefer? Please respond with voice.
After the break.
The second task, I will tell you. Will be to show that one of just a second, let me finish one sentence. The second task will be to show that cone of positive semi-definite matrices is self-dual. So would you like to start working including the break or start after the break? Just respond to his voice. And Katya maybe has some question.
No, I just said I prefer after the break.
After the break, okay. So we meet in 11:32 in 10 minutes.
Okay, thank you, Mr.
User. Okay, we are back from the break. please, response with voice, as usual.
I'm here.
Okay, thank you. And resume your recordings. I did it with mine. And let me start sharing again. Let me start sharing. I should to find... okay. You were with Dulcon. Okay, just a second. I will resume screen sharing. I think this is right window. Yes. Dulcon, let me enlarge my window. And decrease others. Okay. So, we showed. Did you resume recording?
Yeah, I resume recording.
And one more person should be.
I'm recording.
Okay. So we talked about self dual cons and. Okay, I will even give you a hint. So our task now, next classwork, to show self-duality of cone of symmetric positive definite matrices. So it means, first of all, we should show that if two matrices are symmetric positive definite, then the inner product is non-negative. And we define the inner product of two matrices. It's a sum of pairwise products of all the elements, or in other ways, it should be trace X transpose Y, as we know. But for symmetric matrices, I can skip transpose. So we should show that for any two symmetric matrices, this trace is non-negative. And the second task will be that if one of the matrices is not positive definite, say if Y is not positive definite, then I can find a positive definite matrix that inner product will be negative. But let's start with first part, show it, and then we go to the second part. And I even give you a hint that any positive definite matrix can be positive semi-definite, can be represented as a product of some matrix U multiplied by some matrix U transpose multiplied by U. You always can find such decomposition for any positive definite symmetric matrix. Okay, go ahead and try to show that this inner product is non-negative. It's almost trivial, but it's good to do this work. Okay. And you can even respond with voice when you are ready. Okay, now I resumed my recording and stop share. I stopped my sharing, screen sharing. And Katya will show us the solution.
Just about screen share.
Positive definite matrices, that the inner product should be non-negative, yes? Okay, yeah. Okay. We have with you.
So here is the problem. As you said, I can repeat it. Anyway, I just wrote it the dual cone, but for your question, we know that for two positive definite, positive semi definite matrices A and B, the I'm so, yes. if two matrices A and B, if I'm sorry for the mess. Okay, if we have a matrix which is positive semi-definite,
mm-hmm.
which is in K, we know that for any other matrix B in K, which is also positive semi-definite,
mm-hmm.
the inner product of A and B is the trace A transpose B, as mm-hmm. we showed also in the previous lecture. And,
mm-hmm.
and since A and B are symmetric, it's like the trace of the product of A and B.
Mm-hmm.
And according to the following the instructions, since A and B are symmetric, positive, semi-definite, they can be represented as a product of matrix transposed and matrix and matrix. And hence, substituting it, we obtain this, that trace A multiplied by B is actually equal to the trace of U transposed U, V transposed V.
Mm-hmm.
And by the cyclic property of the trace, we can move V to here
mm-hmm.
to obtain trace V U transpose U V transpose, mm-hmm. which is actually the trace of U V transposed multiplied by U V transpose.
Mm-hmm.
I'm sorry, I forgot here transpose was inside.
Mm-hmm.
But this is, there is some transpose issue. Here should be transpose, UV transpose.
Yes, okay, in both, yes. In the parentheses should be UV transpose multiplied here and also in the second, yes.
Yes. So here
on the right should be U V transpose multiplied by U V transpose.
Yes. Yes.
Okay.
Here. And since yes.
Yeah. Sure. Here, no. Just put pointer into right place. 2 centimeters left. Okay. So here we should have U V transpose with U V transpose. Yes. No. Just keep your point. No.
Here we should have.
No, also in other, also in the second.
Yes. Here two transpose.
Move your pointer 5 centimeters right.
Right.
Here. No. Here. Yes, here you should be UV transpose with UV transpose. Yes.
Yes. I'm sorry. So again, here. We have trace of U V transpose and transpose on all of these.
Yes.
Multiplied by U V transpose.
Yes.
Yeah, thanks. Thank you. I should learn to do that. I didn't do
okay,
it.
Okay, no, it's okay. And why is this inner product greater than zero?
Because it's actually the second norm squared of U V transpose.
Yes. It's sum of squares of all elements, yes, of this matrix. Okay, thank you, Katya, thank you very much. So, and this is our conclusion, that if any two symmetric positive matrices, positive definite matrices, the inner product less than zero, then, this is first part of our check, that Kohn is self-dual, yes? Then and the second part of our check, you can stop sharing.
Yeah.
And maybe I will show something on whiteboard. So first we showed that if A and B belong to the SM. Where do I put plus? On the top or on the bottom in the lecture? Yes, SM plus. M plus. Okay, then the inner product A with B is non-negative, yes, greater or equal to zero. This is inner product which will be trace A transpose B. And this is first, yes? And the second, what I want to show, if B doesn't belong to SM plus, then exists A which belongs to SM plus such that AB is less than zero. Okay. Just a second, I will move my camera. And this is your second challenge. It's a little bit more difficult. So if I have a matrix which is not positive definite, I should show that there is some matrix which is positive definite with negative inner product. Any idea how can I approach this problem?
Maybe can I assume B is symmetric?
B is symmetric, yes. B is symmetric and of the same size as A. Otherwise, I could not. Yes, B is symmetric. Yes. You can write formally B belongs to SM, yes?
Michael.
Yes.
You can take, since it's a symmetric and positive semi-definite, it's essentially diagonalized. It has a diagonalizing matrix as a basis. And we can construct a matrix. If B is not positive semi-definite, we can construct a matrix which is diagonalized by the same matrix.
Okay, this is general idea, and it's good. It's good. Good idea. So you can just say that B have some eigenvalues which are non-positive, negative. Sorry, B have some negative eigenvalues. Then I can somehow construct matrix A, which will give it. It's good idea. Go ahead, you can try it.
Maybe we can take if B is negative definite. Maybe we can use a minus B.
No, if B is not positive definite, for example, it has one eigenvalue which is negative, then minus B actually is also not positive definite. Because
minus. Yeah. Not exactly minus, but the inverse operation that gives us from negative definite, the positive definite, with
I didn't say that B is negative definite. You may try, I say that B is arbitrary symmetric matrix. For example, if B has two positive eigenvalues and two negative eigenvalues. Not positive definite, it's not negative definite. And of course, minus B also will be not positive and not negative definite.
Michael, the connection was abroad. Can you please repeat the last few seconds?
Okay. The question was whether can I take B negative definite? I would say that B can have some positive eigenvalues and negative eigenvalues. So it's not negative definite and it's not positive definite, and also minus B as well. So the one way that Katya suggested to go with eigenvalue decomposition of B and say that some eigenvalues are not positive. And let me finish one more proposal, and then I will leave you to work. Just
can we use SVD?
Just a second. Give me a second. If B is not positive definite, I would say then there exists a vector X such that X transpose BX less than zero. Yes? If B is not positive definite. Because yes. This is our definition. Matrix is positive definite, that then for any X, this product should be non-negative. Yes? And if not, then there exists such a vector X. And you can play this. You can consider product of. Okay, you can use this scheme. This is the second scheme. Okay, let's stop with discussion and try working, and raise your hand if anybody has solution. Okay. I stop my microphone. My video will remain on. Okay, is anybody ready? Please raise your hand if you are ready.
I didn't write it all, but I understood your way. Like I understood the solution. I can just instruct. I can't show yet. I understood how to do it, but I.
You can write it down. You can, Katya. You can first write it down, your solution, and Barak, in which way did you do?
The way you proposed.
Of this one, yes.
I think so.
Okay, just go ahead and show us.
Just a second. I didn't write it too clean, so I need to prepare it. So just a second.
Okay, then take your time.
I have a solution, Mikhail.
You have solution on which in which way? Eigenvalues or this one or maybe the third
eigenvalues, the first one.
The eigenvalue, yes?
Yes.
Oh, okay, yes. Go ahead and show us. You can share your screen.
Okay. I'm sharing, just a second. Takes time to connect. Okay. Please let me know if you see the screen.
Yes, yes.
Perfect. So we are talking about the second part. Here we take B to be a symmetric matrix, which is not semi-positive definite.
Mm-hmm.
first of all, since it is symmetric, we know that it is diagonalizable and it's a diagonalized representation. And because it is not semi-positive definite, exists at least one lambda, which is negative. I don't show it here, but I can.
Okay.
Okay. So I denote K to be the index of the which is K, and then I choose A to be just zero everywhere except for the KK element. Now it's
okay, but I think you may have a little bit problem. You should have. It seems to me that you should have eigenvalue decomposition of A with the same basis, P trans P.
Yes, definitely, definitely you are.
So not A, but lambda A, yes? Will be.
Yes, yes, perfect. Thank you. Lambda A.
Lambda A and eigenvectors the same as lambda B, yes?
Exactly.
Yes.
Yes.
So what is trace AB? Yes.
So okay, let's put.
Can you open it to show us? Yes, that it's really what you wrote.
Okay. So first I substitute for A, and then I substitute for B, and now I use the fact that. P transpose is identity.
That P is orthogonal matrix. By the way, P is orthogonal matrix because our matrix original is symmetric, yes?
Yes, yes.
Okay, good.
So not every diagonal is double matrix as an unitary.
In general, it would be inverse. Inverse P lambda P, yes? P inverse lambda P, not P transpose, but okay.
Okay.
Go ahead.
You are right. Okay. So now I'm using that fact to put here an identity, and let's use the cyclic property of the trace to get rid of the other P's. So this P goes here, and if it's okay with you, I just put here identity.
Okay. Good.
Okay.
You get it as trace of product of lambda. Very good. Thank you very much. As product of diagonal matrices. And yes. You say that only the last entrance in A is 1, yes?
Yes.
And all others are 0, and that's why it's lambda k.
Exactly.
It's the last eigenvalue of B, yes? Okay, good.
It is just the k eigenvalue of. I don't know if it's the last. I know that it's.
No, it's on the same position. Yes, you take two diagonal matrices, lambda A and lambda B. Mm-hmm. Lambda B has negative entry on some position kk, and lambda A has 1 on this position, and all others are 0. Okay.
Exactly. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
And I only will show briefly, because we don't have too much time. Yeah, how to go with the second version of solution? Yeah, I say that trace. The trace X transpose BX is less than 0. Let me, I will remove it here. So I say that if B is not positive definite, that X transpose BX is less than 0 for some X, exists some X. So I can instead of write trace, because this is a number, and then I may move X here, and it will be trace X transpose B, and this is my matrix, yes, this is my matrix which trace this is my matrix A, actually. Okay, I don't have enough space here, maybe here. This is my matrix A. So if I choose A is XX transposes rank one matrix, it's column multiplied by row, then inner product with B will be the same as this, and of course it will be less than zero. Okay, so we have two ways to prove things. Okay, and now we can continue to another important issue. So, okay, I may start again screen sharing. Share screen. Okay. Now you see again my slides, and now we are coming to duality. You had a proof in the lecture that if I have a regional conic programming problem in this way, minimize linear objective with conic constraints, then I can develop a dual problem which will look maximize inner product of B with Y. Y are Lagrange multipliers. And Y should belong to the dual cone. The same is in usual duality. We have a vector of Lagrange multipliers non-negative, belongs to dual of positive Artand, and here it belongs to the dual cone. And instead of inequality constraint with the original problem, we have equality constraints that A adjoint Y is equal C, where A is adjoint operator. I am not sure 100% how easy it is for you. That's why we will approach now this issue once more using Lagrange duality. Do you hear me well? I need again some voice responses.
Yeah, I can hear it.
Okay.
Is good.
This issue is a little bit challenging, and to elaborate it a little bit more, I prepared a special slide which show a connection between this duality in conic programming with duality we are familiar with. And let me find this slide. Lagrange conic duality. This is what I was working this morning. Okay, and I will stop share and move screen share to the second one. Okay, and move it here. Reduce it a bit. Oh, takes a little bit effort to reduce it and to move it to the proper place. My screen and increase my video. Okay, so I want to show parallel between conic programming and usual nonlinear programming, which we are already familiar with. So I assume I have a nonlinear programming problem to minimize the nonlinear objective f of x subject to constraints are less or equal zero. And here on the right, I will write down conic programming, which we are already familiar with. Okay. And now I can write down Lagrangian. We are used to write lambda for Lagrange multipliers, but here I write y in order to have a similar notation. So my Lagrangian is objective function plus some Lagrange multipliers by constraints, or I can write it in vector form. It will be y transpose multiplied by vector. Gi, every constraint I can put into vector, so vector of all constraints. So here is my Lagrangian. And if I want to write down Lagrangian for conic program, I do a very similar thing. The only thing, my constraint in nonlinear programming is less or equal zero, and here is greater or equal with conic zero. That's why the term with Lagrangian, I take with minus. I take with minus. So here is plus y transpose by constraint, and here is my minus y transpose or inner product of y with the vector of constraints. And now the most interesting part. We ask what will happen if we maximize, if I maximize my Lagrangian with respect to y. This was our way to develop duality in nonlinear programming. Please somehow respond with some one word to just to be sure the connection is okay.
Okay.
Okay. Okay. Thank you. So how did we do it? I take this expression. Or you can think sum of yi multiplied by gi, and I say what will happen if all gi are less or equal zero, means they satisfy constraints. What will be the maximum of this term if all components of y are non-negative, greater or equal zero? Sorry, it was a little bit corrupted here. So all terms in this sum, this is like sum, and all terms are non-positive, yes, because all g are negative and y are positive. So this sum may be or zero or some negative number, but I want to maximize this. So it's zero. This term will be zero. So the maximum will be just f of x. I will remain with this term. And what happens if one constraint is violated, so it's positive, I can take component of vector y to be positive and very large, as large as I want. So I may drive this maximum to plus infinity. And this was a very central conclusion of duality theory, that if I maximize Lagrangian in y, I get ideal barrier. I get ideal barrier, which means it's objective function when x is feasible, and is infinity when x is non-feasible. Ideal barrier or ideal penalty. This is what's written here. Any question for this? I just reminding you very important and very central stuff. Any question? Any comment about this?
No questions here.
Okay. And now very interesting stuff is coming. Now I wrote a Lagrangian for conic programming in very similar way. It's subjective minus vector of Lagrange multipliers inner product with my constraints. Can I show that maximum of this expression is f of x when x feasible and infinity when x is non-feasible? What is x feasible? X feasible is when this expression ax minus b belongs to the con. Oh, sorry, the only thing, my constraint is y belongs to dual con, to k star. I'm sorry for this mistake. So I have two vectors. Ax minus b belongs to the con. and y belongs to the dual cone, so the inner product is positive, да, or non-negative. Are you with me? I say ax minus b belongs to the primal cone, and y belongs to the dual cone. So here should be k star. So the inner product is non-negative, but with minus it's negative. If I want to maximize it, the best I can do it to go to f of x, to get f of x. And if constraint is violated, then what will happens with this term? Can you help me?
Then it's not in the cone, so it's less than zero, and we can take y to be as large as we want.
So it means if it's not in the cone, I can find a y, yes, that this is negative, and this will be positive, and then I can multiply y by any arbitrary constant. So what I really want you, and I see that we are close to our main, to the end of our main time, and I only want to ask, let me click on participants, please raise your hand, anybody who, those who wants to stay for another half an hour, 40 minutes, to have discussion of this and to have our usual free discussion. So only Ron. Okay, Katya. Okay, only two people. For all others, we will keep it recording. So this is my first task. Try to write down what we told with very rough words. Show that the maximum of this expression just should be k star is what is written here. It's f of x for x feasible and infinity for x non-feasible. This is our first task. And let's meet in how many minutes? Katya and Ron, do you want to meet to write this down and then have some small break? In 20 minutes or in 15 minutes?
I don't care, whatever you prefer.
Huh?
Yeah, it's fine. We can just do it and also so we'll take five minutes break.
We meet, I suggest this way. I suggest everybody to try to write this, but with Ron and Katya, we will discuss it in 15 minutes and we'll try to keep it recorded. Okay? Okay, so thank you very much for participation. It's a very loaded topic and I hope that gradually we will get it. Okay, I will put on pause my recording.
I also paused.
Yes, I resumed my recording. Is Katya here or not yet?
I'm here.
Yes. Okay. So maybe it's nice to summarize if you wrote anything down. Is it okay for you? Or yeah. It's clear or it's messy in your records?
It was okay for me. What about you, Katya?
Okay.
You want to put your records. Okay. Then I will stop my sharing. You know, it's always good to hear in words of students. It may be more clear for other students than when teacher is saying. So it's good advantage of our lessons. So repeat everything twice. Okay.
So in the student voice, as you say, this is the third part. I think fourth assignment. Now we want to show that the maximum of the Lagrangian. Oh, it's too bad I didn't write the Lagrangian here. The Lagrangian, just a reminder, is f of x minus y a x minus b. That is our Lagrangian. And we want to show that the maximum of the Lagrangian over the over y is in the
and it should be k star. It's my mistake. It is k zero. You wrote yes. It should be k star if it's possible.
Over here.
K star yes.
So we will fix it as I go.
And why it's I see zero on your record.
Over here.
Yeah, it should be removed. Yeah, okay. Sorry. It was greater than zero. Yes. It was my mistake. You can.
The word notation.
You can undo it. Yes. Yeah. It's greater with index k than zero. Okay. Yes.
Exactly.
With index k star. It in other ways it belongs to the concatenate k star. Yes. Okay.
Exactly. You are right. So we want to show that the maximum over y is in the cone is f of x if x is feasible and infinity otherwise.
Mm-hmm.
I divide it to cases. Let's start with x is feasible. If it is feasible, then for any y in k star. I.e. y greater equal in k star from zero, the same. We get that the scalar product of y, x minus b, is.
You know, Ron, for the future, maybe not for now, you have an angular parenthesis different than greater equal. No. It should not be round. It should be angular. But
like in the physics, inner product runs.
Yes, but it's for future. If you don't see it now, just leave it as it is.
I don't know, but if it exists,
there is a different sign. But keep it as it was less and greater.
Michael, but maybe it's not exists in war in world this
in LaTeX it is.
But, it LaTeX I know it is yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. Okay, it will be a bit more challenging for me. I will.
No, that doesn't matter. Forget about this. Let's continue.
Okay. So for any y in k star, we know by definition. That this scalar product is non-negative.
Yes.
Now,
by definition of Dolko, yes.
Yes, exactly. And now we also know that if we take y equal to zero, which is in the cone,
mm-hmm.
y to zero, we have the scalar product equal to zero.
Mm-hmm.
So now by considering this term, we know that it's always non-negative, but zero is reachable. Mm-hmm. So zero, we will get the optimal point. For
the
zero,
maximum. Yeah, you'll
the
get
maximum.
Yes.
And so the maximum by putting here the zero, it's f of x. This is the first case. The first case we want to show. Okay, and now I will go to the second case. If it's...
May I ask just a question?
Yes, please.
Of course, the maximum is achieved for zero, but actually, it don't must be zero. There may be another y for which the inner product will be zero. Yes, just for my understanding.
Yes, you're right. But we are interested in the value. The value will be zero. Yes.
So just understand. Thanks.
Yes. Okay. All right. You're right.
Yes.
It's just as example. Ron shows that this is achievable. This is value zero is achievable, but it cannot, it never cannot be larger. Yes.
Exactly. Exactly. So that f of x is achievable. Mm-hmm. F of x is achievable. That's why I was looking for the zero.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Great. Yeah. Okay. Good. So I will go to the second case. If x is not feasible, then it's also by definition exists y, I don't know, y star, mm-hmm. such the scalar product. This scalar product is negative, strictly negative.
Mm-hmm.
Then for any lambda greater than zero, we will get that Lx lambda times this y star is greater than x y star. Why is that? Because this for y star, this is negative. Negative and negative is positive. Uh-huh. And now I take the lambda outside and I get something which is bigger. And
so for any lambda larger than one.
Oh, you are right. For any lambda, thank you. Thank you, larger than one. Yes.
Uh-huh.
Yes, thank you. And I want to use that this fact to show that the value of the maximum for those y in the cone. Now I will stress that here it should be, sorry about that, y star and k star. I will stress that because y is in the cone, then any for any lambda greater than zero, so also lambda greater than one, lambda y star is also in the cone.
Mm-hmm.
It's also in the cone, and now I argue that the value of the maximum over those y star is unbounded from below. And
Of Lagrangian or of this term with minus? Because of Lagrangian, if unbounded from above, yes, Lagrangian can grow as large as.
Yes, from above, yes.
Yeah. Okay, very good, very good. Thank you very much.
You're welcome, thank you.
Okay. I'll stop the sharing.
Okay.
And we will try to continue. Maybe I will continue with sharing my screen. Start share. I hope that this one, yes. Okay. So we get this very nice condition where should be K star here. Okay, where can we go from this? So maximum of Lagrangian is ideal barrier. Also for nonlinear programming, also for, as we show it now, Ron show it, for semi-definite, for conic programming. If we minimize ideal penalty aggregate in X, we get to the optimal X and the optimal value. So if we minimize in X all this stuff, we get F star. F star is the optimal objective function value. And the same is for semi-definite programming. So we get this very nice property. The min max of Lagrangian is our optimal value. It's okay. Are you okay with this? We are now only three people, so we can talk freely.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So and one step more. Do I have one step more? Yes. And this is a trick that we did in the usual duality. We can swap the order of min and max. And by minimax theorem, we say that max min is less or equal than min max. And you get that man mix, max min is less than optimal value. It's something from below and it will connect to the dual problem. And one step more. Okay, and this will bring us to the dual function, and dual function will bring us to the dual problem. This what we already did in nonlinear programming. In nonlinear programming, we defined minimum of Lagrangian as eta of y, and then we to maximize it is this is a dual problem. And the very similar thing we have here. Any question, any comment at this point?
So here we restrict our problem to a cone. Is it okay to, is it correct to say that it is a more specific case of nonlinear programming?
It's not exactly more specific because here inequality is usual. And in conic inequality is special. So we somehow we relaxed because we took objective function and constraints linear, but on the other hand, we generalized, keeping this k. So, and here, maximum along all non-negative, usual non-negative vectors. And here, maximum should be over k star, of course. Y be, maximum over y belonging to the dual cone, and we know we remember in our important cases of usual linear programming and conic quadratic programming and semi-definite programming, the cone is self-dual, so k star and k is the same. But in general, writing should be here k star. And now we can come to the point where we can get, we can develop this dual objective function for this specific case for our Lagrangian. And let me switch here to my whiteboard. I have reserved whiteboard. Just a second.
Okay.
Oops. Here is my reserve. And okay, more close, and even I may stop sharing. Stop share.
Michael.
And give me 1 second, I should manage the whiteboard in order to let you see everything. One more second. Participants. Okay, and this I may minimize. And this I may move here. Give me one more second. I want you to see everything. Yes. Yes, I'm with you, Katya.
No, I just wanted to ask to not stop sharing.
Okay, but it doesn't matter because, you know, all this important, it was done today, yes? So all this important stuff below is on my whiteboard.
Okay, good.
So you can ask, it's by intent, so I have limited space, so I removed it here to start develop this dual function, but you can still ask about this. Yes.
No, I don't have questions. I just wanted to.
Okay. To keep it in front of your eyes. I understand. I will try to keep. Oh, okay. If you say you want to meditate a little bit on this, I can return share for a couple of minutes.
Even just 2 minutes, it's enough.
Okay. Let's do it. Very good. I agree with you. Share. I should find it. I think it's this window, I hope. Yes. Okay. Actually, you know, I may enlarge. Okay. Just think a bit about what is here. It's important, I agree. A lot of information, a lot of new information.
I just want to finish copying. It's not.
You can also do a screenshot or something. Oh, but yeah, okay. Go ahead.
By the way, we
have time.
You know that now we can capture both your screen.
I know that you are doing it, and I also do, but. Yeah, my whiteboard, it's still, I didn't manage it, a little bit smaller, but quality of sound is better on my side. So we still need to have some compromise.
Yeah.
But at least at this point, Katya may continue to copy. It's good. You know, it's actually very good. There is a discussion, a public discussion, that it's very healthy. Who is able to take notes get a very large advantage of getting of lecture material in his head. Through hand, it's coming better.
Michael, I finished.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Good. Okay. For a second, I will stop share and I will resume it later if needed. Okay. So we say that if we minimize Lagrangian in X, it gives us dual objective function, and then maximizing this dual objective function is dual problem. So again, I wrote again Lagrangian for conic programming, and I ask, what is minimum of Lagrangian? So I even can write it down in a little bit. I can denote as x bar as argmin. X L of xy. And then my dual function, eta of y, will be just L, where my x will be fixed, x bar, which is actually will depend on y. So this is our challenge to minimize this expression in x. To write down gradient with respect to x. Wow, gradient with this operator is challenging. But you can try to do it. So first, your first task is develop gradient of this expression and equate it to zero.
Okay,
start working, but keep asking because it may be a little bit challenging.
Would you like us to ask as we go?
Please feel free. If you need, you can ask or just start working.
Okay,
good. Just call me with voice when you are ready or need some help, because I may be able.
Okay.
I hope you do it as usual. You develop a differential, yes? Ron and Katya. You take, if you have dx, what is differential of this expression?
I have the differential, but I do it in my notebook. I obtain that, I'm sorry, the gradient mm-hmm. is c minus the conjugate, a joint.
I told conjugate in the lecture, and I'm very sorry. The correct, more precise word is adjoint. Yes.
I'm sorry. So it's I obtained that the gradient is c minus adjoint a y.
Yes, very good. Would you like to demonstrate it?
But I have not scanned it yet.
You do it on your notebook. Your notebook is your physical notebook.
Yes.
Okay. Good. Very good.
Maybe we can team, because I didn't write it yet. I tried to figure how to do different brackets. Now I can write, as you say, in the world, and
Ron, I suggest you to write. And let Katya to scan, and who will be first will show us. Or maybe let Katya show us.
Okay.
It will take half a minute, Katya. Yes, or how long?
I think 1-2 minutes. Let's see if.
You're just taking picture with smartphone, yes?
Yeah, but I don't know the very sophisticated ways. I just email it to myself and then I...
Take picture with smartphone and send your email to yourself. Yeah.
Yes, this is exactly. Okay. I just check.
I will pause the recording.
No.
And you can share your screen. Yes, Katya might share your screen.
Second, just open it. Yes. Second. I'm sorry for not being multitasking.
No, it's okay.
yeah, it's fine.
sophisticated people may not be able to be multitasking. Okay, good.
So I first I wrote this in your on your board.
Mm-hmm.
The Lagrangian looks like this. The inner product between C and X minus the inner product between Y and the operator A applied on X minus B.
Mm-hmm.
So again, I just show here the gradient. I don't show the final. Maybe Ron can. We want to find the X for which this Lagrangian is the minimal.
Mm-hmm.
So we are computing the gradient of the Lagrangian with respect to X via the total differential with respect. Mm-hmm. So the total differential with respect to X will be the differential of this, of the inner product of C and X.
Mm-hmm.
Minus the differential of the inner product of y with a x minus b.
Mm-hmm.
So by the linearity of the inner product and the differential, we can put the differential inside since c is a constant with respect to x. So it can be written like the inner product of c with the x.
Mm-hmm.
Minus the inner product of y with a dx, since only x is depends on x.
And calligraphic A is linear.
Yes, and calligraphic A is linear. Yeah, exactly. Linear operator. And I can take the operator A to the other side of the inner product. Like I know that the inner product of y with a dx is the same as the inner product of a joint a y with dx.
Mm-hmm.
So I use it here, and by the linearity of the inner product, I combine both the c and the a conjugate, not conjugate, sorry, the joint a y. And with the X, and I by the external of the gradient, by the external definition of the gradient, I recognize that the gradient with respect to X is C minus the joint A Y, and I want to equate it to zero in order to find the optimal.
Yes, but finding optimal x, I am sorry, because you are right. We don't have x in this expression, yes? It's like in linear programming. We don't have x, optimal x. We only have this condition on y. Yes?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. You say that y should satisfy this. If y satisfies this condition, then we can get, but what we can do, we can compute value of Lagrangian in this point.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you very much, Katya, because it will be challenging for you to continue writing you only with mouse. Second part, you can even stop. Stop your sharing. Our second part, so we have this condition. We have this condition that A adjoint Y. Okay. From here, we get, I skip the expression. Oh, should I write it down? Okay, let's write down. So it's C minus A adjoint Y, yes?
Yes.
Okay. I just summarized what you did. Katya and Ron, are you with me?
Yes. Yeah. Always fine. Always
oh, okay.
Fine.
Actually, pay attention that I could more easily to get to this conclusion. I just could in the objective function it's itself. I could use a adjoint y inner product with x. Forget about b. And here is C in the problem with X. But in any case, you get to it nicely. So we can conclude that from here we get that C is equal. A adjoint Y is equal C. But pay attention. What will be L of x bar y when this is satisfied? Yes. Let me see. What will be L optimal? L star of y. What will I have? I will have this cx. I'm not sure whether I have enough room. Minus I put a adjoint here, a adjoint y. Inner product with x, yes. If I move it here, but I told that this should be the same, yes. I can remove it, and what I will have plus b transpose y. Okay, are you with me?
Yes, yes.
So the conclusion is very interesting, that if I choose y in the way that Lagrangian has minimizer, it should satisfy this condition, then my objective function is just b transpose y. And this is actually not L star, but we already have not. Notation is a et of y, dual function.
So this is the dual function.
So it is this when y satisfies this constraint, and if y doesn't satisfy this constraint, then I can minimize in Lagrangian. It has some slope. Yes, it doesn't have slope zero. It will be minus infinity. Maybe I will move at this point to my lecture slides. Let me try to do it, where I summarize all this. Lagrange conic. Just a second. Introduction to optimization. And let me continue sharing screen. Am I recording?
Yes, you are.
Thank you. Just a second. I should share screen. Stop screen share. And hope this is right window. Yes. And let's see what I have. I tried to summarize here what we were writing. Okay. Let me even increase it a little bit. To see it better. Okay, I tried to summarize what we had until now. So we started with parallel of linear, nonlinear programming and conic programming. we show that maximal of Lagrangians should be K star here is infinity when x not feasible and f of x is if x feasible mean it's ideal barrier. Then if I minimize it in x, I get optimal function value. And now I want, I wrote that by minimax theorem, max mean is less or equal than this value. And now I want to maximize my Lagrangian. The only thing here should be written in Dolcon. Y should be in Dolcon. So, and this what we found that gradient is C minus A adjoint Y. And when we substituted like I did on my whiteboard, we got to the conclusion the dual function is B inner product with B with Y when this is satisfied and minus infinity otherwise. And so the dual problem. This is our dual problem. Actually, we did everything. I need just to conclude. Let me write here in more clean way. We don't need any more. So we get after every, all this will be canceled for this. I summarize. Just a second. I will summarize that my dual objective function eta of y is equal. Instead of b transpose y, I will write inner product is equal inner product of b with y. When constraint is satisfied, when A adjoint Y is equal, do you see well?
Yeah. We see the.
I need to remove some window to remove reflections. Just a second.
Also see the screen of your computer reflecting in the board.
Yes. This is exactly what I'm trying to do, to remove bright things on my screen.
It's okay, you know.
Okay.
It's okay. You can still clearly see the.
Okay. The good. And so, if I will minimize in X, when I have such a Y that my gradient with respect to x is not zero, I can go with this slope to minus infinity. So it's minus infinity. Here a adjoint y equal to c. Otherwise, and I conclude that my dual problem. Will be maximize this expression b y subject to a adjoint y. I hope that you see well.
Yeah.
Equals c. Because it is I trying to maximize, I try to get to some values. If it will be not equal C, it's minus infinity. Of course, I can achieve better values than minus infinity if they exist y that satisfies this condition. So we got the development of dual problem in our usual way, which is a little bit different than in the lecture. But I should say that I have special video on this. So we did by ourselves with hands, but I have nice video which very briefly summarize it, very shortly, but clear in clear way does everything we did now. So you can watch it at home.
Okay.
Any question, any remark, any comment?
Michael, the video is for the next lecture, or how is the video you mentioned now?
Yes, towards next lecture, you will have two videos. The one is the basic, the linear conic programming 2. And the other is additional, which actually we did now in the class, and it will be very easy for you to watch it.
Oh, very good.
Okay. Yeah, that's great.
Okay.
So, Michael, that's it? Or
Yes, we had much more in the lecture, but I think we should finish. Otherwise, we will overload ourselves and also our listeners and viewers.
Michael, I have actually a question. Just very general, not about the material.
Yes.
It's good that Ron is here because Ron knows more than I about this stuff. I think there is a big chance that our exam may be canceled because it's on the end of the exam period, and now all this corona. Thing is being worse.
Yes, it's a very important question.
Maybe we can stop recording because anyway it's...
Yeah.
I don't know, maybe it's good to record. Maybe for other students it will be important to hear. What do you think?
Good question. Maybe it's good
I will pause
it stopped because anyway it will be emailed at the end. So.
Alt P. Did my recording stopped?
No. Not yet, it says recording.
A second.
Sometimes I need to do it manually.